Dan West again, and gonna change gears a little bit here from the workshop. I've got something that I'm gonna do to my home, the front door entry. I've always wanted to put some handrails there. We got about three steps. My wife and I both have our offices here, and my wife's an accountant, so right now it's tax season. Have a lot of people coming in and out, but I've been wanting to do it, so bite the bullet, gonna do it now. But I got to thinking, this might be a pretty good little thing to put up on YouTube for someone who might be in a same situation. You know, when it comes to handrails and stairs, I've built a lot of them. Most of them been in wood. I've never done any steel, but there's a lot of ways to do it. Depending on the condition, depends what you want. This is going to be very simple. Again, you know, 68 years old, I'm not worried about building a mansion. I don't want to look like trash, but, you know, I want to look somewhat decent. Main thing is I want it sturdy. Now, I'm going to go by a step-by-step process as best I can so that some of you out there who, you know, might have the same situation but don't know quite how to go about it and, you know, might not have, you know, the means to put that kind of money out because, you know, a skilled man's going to want to get paid for it and all that, and there are a lot of good ones out there. There are a lot of ways to do this. There's different types of, you know, metal adaptations to be done, all that. I'm just saying the way I'm going to do it is the way I've done it in the past, and I've put a lot of kind of like boutiques in, and where I've had to have freestanding items in the middle, and the walls have got to be, or clip walls have got to be pretty sturdy. So what I usually do is core holes and put pipes, steel pipes in the ground, and then usually cover it with wood or whatever, you know, to conceal it. But it makes it very sturdy. Again, you can buy these things that, you know, just lag bolt into the surface. I've seen them in bricks and all that kind of stuff, but I don't know. I think you get a pretty good sized person lean on that thing. It'll go, you know. But hey, it depends. You know what you want, how you want it to look. I don't mean to say make it sound bad, but the way I'm gonna do it, you can bet it's gonna be pretty solid. again, I'm gonna show you a few, I think, methods. When you're dealing with stairs, it's really critical to keep minimum heights, maximum heights, that type of deal. There's a lot of, guidelines that you've got to stay within the parameters, especially when you're dealing with code and whatnot. Out here, the minimum height for me, I'm going to go to minimum, is 34 inches. And I'll probably be breaking these things down in inches and meters. You know, like I say, I still like to work in meters, but I'm sure I'll get some flack on that, but it's all right. Big boy, I could take it. Just bring it on, you know. So, with that, I'm going to show you the little plan I drew to give you an idea of what I'm talking about, and then we'll go to the front entry and show you what's going to be done. I'm not going to be able to finish it today because I got to go bowling. So I'll do as much as I can, and then the actual installation and whatnot will happen a little bit later, okay? So with that, I'm going to go take this thing over to the little sketch I drew. Okay, bye. I thought I'd add a note to this video here that it's just why I'm doing this myself. You know, I had thought about doing this, and I explained why we need to do this, and I feel the urgency to have it done now because of the traffic we've got coming out of the house to my wife's tax clients coming out. But I have got so much on my list of things to do. I'm still working in her office, doing some millwork, and as well as the house, and of course my shop, and I've got so much to do. I got to think, you know, why don't I just get a wrought iron fabricator, yeah, blow this thing out in just an hour or two, you know, here at the house, you know, fabricate it in the shop, bring it out and install it, and gone. So, you know, I started looking around to get some ideas what it costs. Well,
Out here in California, it's $100 a foot. And I've got two rails at 8 feet. That's 16 feet, $1,600. And I said, no, no way. So I got thinking again, you know, this video really might be even better, I thought, for the fellow who doesn't have that kind of money or just doesn't want to put that kind of money out and can still do it for a lot less. I mean, I'm going with oak, and I'm going with each rail is going to have three laminated 1x6s. That's six 8-footers, and that's cost me $200 at Lowell's. And that's, you know, they're pretty decent boards. You can go through them. There's nothing wrong with them for what I'm going to use them for. So a guy could really, you know, save himself a lot of money and still, you know, make his house look nice. I mean, I guarantee you these things aren't going to look decent when I get done with them, because the house is going to be repainted and it's going to match the rail colors. It's a kind of a gray blue right now, but we're changing it all to the warm colors of the volcanic rock that's been placed in the front. It's kind of reds and browns, whatnot, you know, and earth colors. So it's going to look nice, you know, and it's going to be a far cry from $1,600. I can't guarantee you. And so, you know, if this video even helps just one person out here who's in that same situation, I feel it'd be worth it. So just a little brief explanation as to why I'm doing it myself. And with that, I'll see you in the shop. Okay? Okay, here we go. This is a little quick sketch I just kind of threw together. This is the bracket that I'm using. It's pretty sturdy. Where am I here? Okay, excuse me. Pretty wide. Pretty hefty bracket. Now, I know it's not really pretty, but it's going to do the job. And, you know, when it's all said and done, the main thing is when Granny's going down the steps, she's not going to take a header, you know. This here represents the wall, okay? So the bracket's going to go up against the wall here. And then you can see where this big block, it says oak rail. I was going to use a 2x6, but with a 1-inch pole being drilled up into the base at the landing, that didn't give me a lot of meat on either side. And I realize it's just the sides, but still, I just wanted something a little more substantial. So instead of going with that, because I had another piece of, clear 2x6 Doug fir, you know, from my bench build, and but I want something a little more beefy. So I'm going with the oak, and I'm going to get, I'm going to glue three-quarter pieces together. It's going to be 2 1/4 width. And that's it right there, sketched. So I'll have plenty of beef going inside that that pocket with that 1-inch galvanized pipe going up in it. That's basically it. I got an offset from the wall to the center of the pipe, 3 inches. And, you know, there's not too much to this. Really isn't. You just get your heights and all that. The main thing is the angle, where your horizontal piece meets your riser. And that's where a lot of people can kind of get confused. This is going to be a real simple layout installation, so anyone can really do it. So I'm hoping I can explain it clear enough. And then, if you happen to have a situation, go get it. You know, it should work out just fine. We'll go to the front porch entry now and take a look at what I'm talking about. So here we are. We've got our height established on both top and bottom. We've got that leg secured, 34-inch leg secured, post. And hit that at the ground. Now, what I did was, I measured over from the wall, 3 inches at the center, brought that line back down. What I actually did is I got the, that is the wall, actually. Then I measured over 3 inches, all right? And I came off the same dimension from the step to the center line, which turned out to be about 7 3/4 inches. I'm doing all this in inches for you guys. I usually work in millimeters, but, I'm sure I'm going to get some flack from some people someday about using meters, but
no big deal. I work both ways. And I got to center, and I draw a center line. Now I'm going to have those two holes cored out, nice and neat, and then I'll dig it out. And like I said, at the bottom of that that galvanized pipe, I'm going to screw a hole through it, and I'm going to put a lag. I'm going to put a bolt nutted in both ends, so the bolt sticking out on both sides of that pipe. And once it's in the concrete real good, it won't move. It won't spin or turn around. That's all I need. So this is it. Short and sweet. I hope it's clear enough. You know, the average guy can do this. It's not that hard. And simple rail. The layout's the most important thing. You get that. And the same layout is over here. Okay? I got the same layout over there. Right? Tape, the heights. With this configuration here, I'll be able to show you how I'll lay out for the rails, cut them, and I'm sure I'm going to probably put a Morrison tenon at the joint of the two, and then just drill thread into the bracket, and then plug the holes, with the plug, make it nice and neat looking. Other than that, I'll see you next time. Bye. Okay, here we go. Hole number one for the handrail. Okay, here we are, looking at the bench, and on the foreground there to the right, that is the 1x6 8-foot lengths of oak that I have just being stored right now. I clamp them straight because I try to help to keep them from moving. I know they're dried and everything, but still, while they're not in use, I want to keep them as straight as possible. And to the left there, that's poplar. That's the template I made. So I can lay each board out and cut it accordingly. And it's been glued. I used dowels this time, a doweling jig. And it's right on. It's right on the mark. So the right side has a slope to it. I'm not going to worry about it. I'm just going to make two the same. That's just the way it is. I'm not going to make two templates. And so again, I've got this clamped. Did it last night or yesterday. And I got it clamped in position so it'll stay straight. Again, it's just wood. It's poplar, so it'll move. But it's all dried, and I'll be taking it apart. A little bit later on today to start cutting the oak, because here I have already started with the pipe, and I'm going to stick the pipe in the ground very soon here. I just wanted to show you where I've gotten so far. Now the wall, of course, is way out. It's not straight. So what I had to do is I lagged located studs, and I lagged the two brackets in position on both sides. All right. Now, this morning, what I did was, since the wall is so out, I have to locate these two pipes exactly on center so they'll come exactly underneath the railing when it comes out. So what I had to do was I got these two 2x4s extended, as you can see on both sides. And I had my wife help me with the dry line, hook it to the back bracket, then measure off the wall the amount of distance to locate the face of the bracket. And that's the line you see right there, the face of that bracket. And I'm going to add to that another dimension that brings me out to 2.5 inches total. And that's going to be the face of the pipe, and from there I'm going to plumb down on my proper distance. I've got the line there on the plywood on both sides,
and that is the face of the pipe. So what I mean by that is the pipe will be on this side, coming away from the steps. That 1-inch mark will be there for the pipe. And accordingly, respectively, on the 2x. So that's what I'm doing today. I'm going to set that with both these pipes. And everything is braced, as you can see, sufficiently for this process. And when I'm done setting the pipe, we'll be back. Okay, here we go. I want to show you what I have going here as far as setting the poles. As you can see, I've got a bolt that's threaded into the window pole. That'll keep it from turning into cement. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to level it and plumb it. As you can see, the 2x4 gives me the location off the wall with relationship to the brackets also. And with that calculation, I figure how much to move over from the bracket to be centered into the handrail. And then with my little electrician's level here, I'll just plumb it, and then on both sides. And as I put the cement in, it's going to hold in place. So pretty simple way of setting a post in this particular situation without having to put a lot of 2x's crisscross and brace and everything. I'm on blacktop here, so it's not like you can put a stake in the ground. So I already did this one. It's already poured in place, and it'll sit there for a couple days or so anyways, you know. Well, it didn't take long to do it, but I like to let my thing set up pretty good. I won't be touching it for probably 3-4 days at the most, because, at least I should say, because when I cut my 1x6s in the railing, I'm going to be gluing them. And when I glue, like I say, I let mine sit up for a few days anyways before I take all the clamps off. Well, then I've got some detail work to do on it, finish the ends, rounding, and I'm also going to finish them before I actually set them in place. So when I set them in place, they're going to be all ready to go. So with that, showing you how everything's kind of set up here, I'm going to get back to work and mix the cement and pour this last one, and we'll go from there. The next view will be in the shop. So with that, see you in a little bit. Okay, here we go. In the shop. And one of the first things you want to do when you get ready to start cutting your material is just select the best pieces, since we are going to be gluing 3 sections at a time, meaning the 1x6s. And we're going to be cutting them in a specific order. You want to go through first and select your best ones for the exposed face, which would be on the inside of the entry. And then, of course, the worst of the lot, you want to put those in the center. And the next to the worst would be facing the wall, such as this one here. This is the only one that has that kind of a situation, but it's going to be the face facing the wall. These two are going to be in the inside of the laminate. And these 3 here, they're good both sides. As you can see here, I'm marking with chalk. I mark all my finished wood with chalk because it's the easiest to remove. Pencil is one of the worst. Sometimes you've got especially if it's a soft wood, you do leave an indentation trying to sand it out. So. And of course, you put scotch tape, some kind of a masking tape on it, you're always concerned about falling off. If you're in dire need of just using just pencils alone, if you can, mark it somewhere where it's going to be like the drop-off or not seen. But, you just can't go wrong with chalk. It's just so easy, and, it's clearly visible, and it comes off real easy. Other than that, these are the pieces I'm going to start fabricating and see in a little bit. Okay, this is glue-up day. And I thought before I got too far ahead of myself here, I would go over this a little bit. As you can see,
I've got everything glued up according to my template. And I'd like to show you something that's kind of an easy way to glue this kind of a joint together. You know, when you've got an angle like this, you want to get some pressure on what you're, you know, what you're trying to put together. And sometimes it can be difficult. And what I want to show you here is what's called pinch dogs. Now, this is on the inside. It's not going to be seen. And all these pieces have a blind side where you could do your marking, whatever. And in this case here, here's my pinch dogs. Again, I'm using dowels again. I don't use dowels that much, but I'm using dowels this time. And to really bring it together tight, these pinch dogs really, really help. You can screw blocks and use clamps and all different ways you can do it, but these things are really handy. I've had these for a number of years, and they've always served me well. So as you can see, I had them stacked up here. And I already started, what I'm doing is detaching them, and I'm giving them a rough sand with some 80 just to kind of rough the surface up so it'll absorb better the glue. And I'm not trying to smooth it, just trying to scuff it up. And with that, I'll show you what happens, you know, in the next process of just, I use a roller. When I roll my glue on, I put it on, and I use a roller, and I glue both sides. I don't put a glue side up against the dry side. It's just something I've taught years ago. Never had a problem. Usually I have one good wet side, and the other side is, you know, just tacky. Doesn't have to be real wet either, but it's a better way to have alleviate from, you know, dry spots. Again, this is my preference, and it's always served me well, and I think it's a good way to go, you know. So with that, I'll continue the sanding process, and then continue clamping it up, and I'll be back a little bit, okay? Right. Okay, here we are. We're all glued up. When I'm gluing, and I might have mentioned this before, but I was always taught, it's really best to glue both sides of anything, just to, even a tenon. You know, glue your tenon and glue the mortise also. Put glue on both surfaces. It just assures for a better bond. Now, you know, I know a lot of guys just glue one side and go with it, and it holds. But, you know, when you think about it, you glue one side really good and at least give a good tacky on the other side. This is what I do here, for example. Long piece like this, kind of wide, 6 inches. I'll always use a roller. And for big areas like panels, I'll use this kind of a squeegee. And I'll cut teeth into it. And then I'll go back over with a roller to smooth it out, to make it nice and consistent. Sometimes I use a pan like this if I find the need. In this case, gluing these up, it was handy to have a little glue in there instead of pouring it from the bottle and just using just the pan and my roller. And it's all cleaned up. It cleans up real easy. You use it again. But I'll tell you, it makes it so much quicker and easier. And it's far better than just taking a glue bottle and just going zigzag across on the edge and then gluing it up. I mean, you know, I know it'll hold, but, you know, there's a lot of ways to do things. And I like to do things the best, you know, really. And I'll tell you, my sister will hold up a lot longer than, you know, just a few zigzags or whatever. Anyways, so the three each are glued up, and the two rails together are glued together. And I'm using this 4x6 here as it's a pretty straight piece of wood. So I've been using it a few times. I use it to some leftover for when I'm making a redwood door. Oh, a couple years ago. Anyways, this is it. Glued up. This is the way it's going to stay for 3 days. I'm not touching this thing for 3 days. And then there's always some touch-up to do. I'm going to trim the ends, give it some detail, use edges to break and all that. And Came out pretty good. I'm real pleased with it. And what else can I say about the glue up? Other than that, here's my bench. Here's my Rubo bench, but it is protected. That's the way I do work, you know. I like to keep my stuff nice and clean, and cardboard's cheap, and it is really handy. So I protected my bench this way, and I've got wax and all the 4x4s you see there that the whole assembly is sitting on, so that when the glue does drip, it'll be on the wax and not bond to the raw wood. These other pieces you see on the table here were used to lay the members on those boards as I was gluing them. I had to go, you know, forward and backwards. The center pieces of each assembly got glued on both sides. So other than that, that's it. Again, small shop, but you can get things done. I got to roll things around, but that's it. I'll see you in probably 3-4 days when I get back to this thing and take it apart and start working it. And I got a couple little surprises I might put into it, like I mentioned before. Other than that, we'll see you later. Bye bye. Okay, here we are. It's been 4 days. Had a bit of rain during this period, so got an extra day of clamping, and I had other things to do. So it's been 4 days. I've been glued up, and we're going to take the clamps off and now start doing some detail work on these two handrails. And I'll maybe stop periodically to show you what I'm doing, and we'll go from there, okay, as it this handrail project marches on. You know, I just had to stop a minute here and show you something about this Rubo bench. Now, look at this object I've got here. It's a pretty beefy handrail. And, you know, I'm trimming it right now. I'm sanding it, and I'm going to get ready to do some router work on it. But, you know, figure doing this on sawhorses or something. Look how my dogs have got this thing set. One there at the end. I've got one over here. I've got one in here to keep it moving forward. One right back here. And I got the end. I got these two dogs going back. Actually, I should be this way. On the end. And I got these blocks in here. And it's not going to go either way, left or right, forward or backward. I mean, you know, I made a video earlier for the guy who works in a garage like I do. No space, working on sawhorses and plywood and 2x4s like I used to. I'll tell you. I mean, this is really the only way to go. You've got to have some kind of a really decent workbench. And this style of bench, it can hold just about anything in any configuration. I've yet to been stumped where I couldn't clamp something down on a bench like this, especially the one with a split top where you could remove the centerpiece and put big F-clamps in the middle or something if you had to, you know. Anyways, I just thought I'd kind of throw that in there. I'm going to get back to finishing this thing and then continue with this handrail. Thank you. Well, here we are. The two handrails are finished. I didn't bother with going through all the boring details of finishing them, but just for sake of saying so, you know, after I had them glued up, these surfaces here on the ends are going to be not smooth on both sides. So I hand planed them down and got them smooth, and of course there's a lot of sanding involved. I located the handrails in place so that I could find the proper drilling for the holes in the brackets. I'm just going to go with a carriage bolt, a quarter 20 carriage bolts, 3 inches, and with a lock washer and a nut on the backside. I thought of a different ways of doing it, but this is probably the most simplest. I don't want to get too exotic. I was thinking of a lot of different ways of doing it, so if there was no, you know, a bolt or anything seen, it should be a clean handrail. But you know, I can do it, but I just didn't want to go through all the work, so I figured, what the heck, you know. Anyways, it's sanded. It's sanded. I've got a pretty good sander, Festool, you know, orbital sander. It's like the old Rockwell years ago, the old Chromey, we used to call them. Anyways, 80, 120, 220, right down to 600. A little quarter round on it, and I hope you can see that. It's a nice little quarter round on the on all edges. And I'm going to go with some Watco oil, medium walnut. I think that's going to be pretty good. Because like I said before, it's something like with the chop is right there, except maybe a little bit darker. Because our house right now is blue and gray, and that's all. Those colors are all going to go more of a brownish tone, because her dad years ago had put lava rock in the front of the house. I'm just going to kind of match those colors throughout, so the handrail will match. It'll look odd right now, but the next thing we're going to be painting the house, so it'll match up real nice. So that's it. They're all set to be installed. Like I said, the holes are all drilled for the pipe located. It's been they're both right on the money on the layout. So I'm going to start finishing these. It's going to take a while, and I thought maybe I'd show you one other thing, how I got these things lapped. There's the seat. If you can see it, you see it very clear. There you go. See that piece there? I've got them. I've got the centers lapped. So all three pieces are lapped, jointed, and I was thinking even putting dowels and all that through there, but you know what, I'm getting crazy again. So it's all doweled, but the lap joints are pretty good. And you can see, like, for example, here, one of the dowels is coming through. That's where the cross pieces were, you know, were matched up in between the two outer pieces, and the dowel came through on that, which is no problem. It's at the bottom. Both of them are that way, and I don't mind that at all. So it's pretty solid. Glued up really well. I always roll the glue on both sides. And in this case, like I said, these things set up for 4 days, because I usually let them set for three, but we had some other things to do. We had a bowling tournament to go to, so that's why I extended a day or two there. Anyways, that's it. You know, I hope you don't mind that I didn't show you the boring details of me hand planning these things. I didn't see any need to do that, but you know what, in terms of finishing it and sanding it and whatnot. So, with that, I'm going to start finishing these things, and I'll see you in a couple days. Okay, bye. And here we are, first coat of varnish on top of a Watco medium dark walnut stain, and that's one application of Watco flooded and not wiped off. I let it dry overnight, and I have just finished applying the first of at least four coats of this exterior shellac Man of War. So that's it. I got 4 days of this, at least 4 days of this, depending how it looks. But I'm going to put at least four coats on this, and I don't know, looking pretty good, I think. I guess it'll look real nice. Again, like I said, the house's colors are, as you can see, are blue and gray, kind of a blue one. But, excuse me, shut me down. But they're going to be all earth tones, browns, and various colors of dark and light brown. So it'll match up real nice. So I hope you like it. Again, if you've got any questions, please feel free to contact me via my email address. I do not have a website. I'm new at this video stuff, as I'm sure you probably can tell. If you got some critiques, by all means, let me have it. So you learn, you know. So for more than anything else, I hope this helps someone who might have a similar situation, especially when you work in a garage like I do, a small shop. You really can do a lot, you know. Just have to move stuff around. But I guess that's it. I'll be putting four coats on, and next time I'm going to video this. It'll be installing these babies. By the way, I'm going with, as you can see with the pre-drilled, I'm going with carriage bolts and a lock washer and a lock nut on the back of the bracket. And the brackets, I had mentioned I was probably using some kind of a molly or something, but or toggle bolt. But no, those brackets are located into studs, and they've got they're threaded with I believe they're 3/4 what do you call it? oh shoot, I'm forgetting that. You know the real heavy lag bolts. Lost my brain there. So I believe 1/4 or 3/8 lag bolts are in the studs there. So it's more than solid. And, the pipes are painted. The brackets are painted. I even got the lag bolt heads and the nuts and the washers, lock washers painted. So those are primed right now. Those are finished painted on the wall and the pipes. So, with that, I'll see you in probably another 5 days at least, because for each day is a coat. I got to wait 24 hours for it to dry. Light sanding, another coat. That's 4 days right there. Another day to let it rest is 5. So, depending on what my schedule is, I hope I'm going to be free to install them that day. I'll post this, make another picture of it, post it, and I hope if anybody sees it, they like it. See you then. Bye. Hi there. Dan West again. I came across something during this period of applying varnish to these rails. I'm a woodworker. I am not an expert at paint or stains. I've done it. But there's a lot that I don't know. I've been around a lot of good workers and all that. I've watched them and I do what they do. But as far as knowing how to mix certain things, stains and cutting agents and whatnot, I still have to read the cans to find out how to clean the brushes. So I'm varnishing these rails. Like I've done it before, doors and everything. But I really understand now why they say, thin coats. Because I, on both sides, on both handrails and on the face sides of the long runs of these rails, I had runs, big runs, and I mean, I was sick. The second application, I tried to sand it out, and by the third application after sanding, it was still there, and I'm saying, what am I going to do? So I had a couple of days of wind that stopped my production of applying coats, and the other morning I woke up thinking, I've got to do something. I've got to try to do something. I was thinking of using a scraper, cabinet scraper, but I'm thinking, it's, pretty close. What if I go too deep and all that? Then I got to thinking, I have a little strip of oak, and I'm thinking, why don't I do like I do a lot of times on my bench? I have a straight piece of wood, sometimes a long piece, and I'll use sanding paper comes off of rolls. And I use that like a plane to straighten out surfaces. You know, we've done it in France a lot of times, and all different grains of sand and paper, you know. So I got 320, full sheet, and I wrapped it around this piece. I'll show you later, and I'll tell you what. For a lot, I'm sure there's a lot of guys out there in the same position as me, you know, they do a little cabinet work or make little things or whatever, and, you know, to not pay a guy, a professional, really, to do it, you try it yourself, and, you know, you hit or miss. This really worked, because it's flat, straight, and I always went with the grain, and I even, a lot of times, I just, like a plane, I stroked it, lifted it up, put it back, and stroked it again. I didn't go back and forth sideways, you know. I actually went the same stroke all the time. Didn't make a difference. The drips are gone. I mean, they're gone. So, you know, anyone out there, you know, I went on YouTube. How do you get rid of runs? I didn't get that from anyone. I mean, I for 2 days, I searched YouTube to find someone, some pro out there, to tell me how to get rid of stains. I'm sure it may be out there, but I didn't find it. But I'm telling you, this works. You get a straight piece of hardwood, and you fold your paper tight, and you go across that a run area, and you'll see it, and then you just kind of work it, and just be careful. Try to keep it very flat to where you're just riding on that hump of running varnish, and I'll tell you what, it'll go away, and you know you got to apply coats. This is my fourth coat. I'm going to put at least two more. I may put four more coats in this thing. I may go to eight coats. I'm going to go at least six, but I may go. I'm just not going to be in a hurry to put these things up. I want these things to finish out really nice and smooth and have a good coat because, you know, these are going to be outside. And luckily, it's a northern exposure. I don't get a lot of sun on them until later on in the day. So, you know, see what happens. But I thought this would be a worthwhile excerpt to add to this, you know, an addendum to this because, you know, this build, because I'm sure a lot of guys, you know, I didn't know how to do this. I'll tell you what, this works. And I'll show you the two areas now. I wished I would have filmed this before so you could see these before and after runs, because they're not there now, but believe me, they were really drippy and big in both areas on the face. And I'll show you the little board I used, you know, just a, you know, picture's worth 1,000 words. So let me turn this off, and while I'm taking this off the tripod, and I'll show you what I did here. Okay, here it is. Just a really simple piece of hardwood, just oak, and it's actually very lucky because it just about perfectly fits the size of this sheet of paper in terms of rolling it, you know, four times. There we are, like this. And I can use, you know, I think I used three of the four sides. This side wasn't used, but I'm going to use a new sheet. This is another day. I'm going to use another new sheet. I'm going to fold this up. And the runs were here. You can see there's no runs on this thing. But I'll tell you what, there was a big run right about here. I mean, huge. Same thing over here. That's the full length, and this other set of runs was right in here, and you can see there's nothing there. I mean, it was ugly. It was ugly. So, again, I hope this will help someone out there who, same boat I am. I'm not a finisher by any means, but like a lot of amateurs, you know, we buy the stuff, we read the cans, and I'll tell you what, I have another respect. Greater respect for when they say thin coats. Apply thin coats, because the thicker your coat is, the more you're looking at having some kind of a run, especially on your vertical areas. So with that, I'm going to turn this off and get back to work. And this is my fifth coat, and I'm probably going to do, if not six, to, you know, eight coats total. So here we go for another week, and I'll see you in a few days, okay? Bye. Well, here we are. Dan West here again. And this is a day we've been looking for. These babies have been curing for about, at least 4 days now, 4 or 5 days. had a little bit of weather, plus, again, had a bowling tournament to attend. So, we've got some extra curing days. We've got all the coats on it, all the 8 coats. And it's looking really, really good. I'm going to go ahead and set the tripod up. And I don't have any microphone equipment. You know, I'm doing everything off this this build with my iPad, my Apple iPad. So I don't have any equipment. Like I said before, I'm really new at this stuff, so I made some mistakes. I know by turning the camera on. I'm sorry about that, but I'll try to mend my ways and do better. But let me set this up on the tripod and kind of show you how I'm going to set this thing up, attach them, and probably later I'll go through and put some dialogue in it to better explain it. But anyways, I'll see you in just a bit, okay? Well, here we are. The day that I've been looking for, anyways, to finish this thing. It's been several weeks. Weather notwithstanding and bowling tournaments and all. And the finishing, you know. Standing, waiting to dry. Then the varnishing and all the coats of varnishing and 24 hours in between coats to dry, and again, it's been long, it's been tedious, but it's been well worth it. I tell you what, getting back to the money, it cost me $275 to core the two holes, $200 for the oak, and that's basically about it. You know, the one piece of 3/4 galvanized pipe, of which a friend of ours was trying to tell me it was too small, it wouldn't hold, but you know, I know better. I've done too many of these things. This thing is solid. Don't get me wrong. This thing is really solid. And like I said, you see the color of the house is blue and gray or whatever you want to call it, but it's going to be earth tones. You see the lava rocks down there. That's what we're going to be going off with, the stucco and the wood trim and everything. But all in all, I'm real pleased with it, you know. It's very solid, does the job, it looks nice, and, you know, as you can see, it's midday, we don't get a lot of sun here, it's northern exposure, so even the weather won't be too harsh on it, even though it's outside. And I've got 8 coats of varnish in this thing, so, this thing is well set up, prepared, and I think I showed you all in the cuts and everything. Hope you can see it. See how the lap joint is? Even my wife was asking about it. But you
see that? It goes. The matching piece of that is going from this angle down to the corner here, and in that joint in between the sandwich of the outside pieces, it's doweled. Just like this joint is doweled, and the joint on the other side is doweled. But all these joints are broken by a solid piece. There's no single joint that's matched with another joint. It's broken, so it's actually glued really, really solid. Other craftsmen know what I'm talking about. I hope those of you who are new to woodworking can kind of understand what I'm talking about. But this goes from here to here on this piece, and it's doweled like this, just like these are doweled, like here on both sides. And so when this is overlapped, and these two, then the center goes in between, it's a solid, solid glue joint. Very, almost like a mortise tendon, but in this case, I think even better, you know. So, and then the carriage bolts, nice and clean, you know, and the brackets. I mean, this thing is solid. This thing is pretty solid. So, I think it looks nice. The joints are nice and clean. See how clean the joints are? Nice and tight, all the way around. Okay. So, again, I hope this really, you know, for a person who's in kind of the same situation, this thing would have cost me a fortune using wrought iron. And I'll tell you what, I'm talking very simple wrought iron, nothing decorative. So this looks nice, a lot nicer, and it's really strong. And you know, here's my bench, all covered up and stuff. So I think it was a good project, and I hope it's going to be helpful for somebody. Again, please forgive my amateurish, you know, video work here. I'm learning, and I don't have a lot of top-notch equipment, but the main thing is to get the story out, and I don't make a living at this, but I think it is very helpful, you know. It's been for me and for other people, too, maybe. So with that, say thank you. If you have any comments, please don't hesitate to... My email is right down there. I don't have a website. Give me a call. Let me know. Critic, whatever, I can take it. You know, I can understand if I got things wrong. You know, let me know. No problem. And with that, I'll see you on the next project. Bye-bye.